ones, I can't use the cheap ones anymore on this.
Good.
So I had these cheap picks that I got off Amazon that I gave to my students. So I had extra. I was like, oh, I'll just use them, right? So I could grab them for shows and I started using them here, but they break really easy. And they break their fur on my pick mix. I was like, you're kidding me. So, yeah, yes.
Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Hallelujah. Thank the Lord for the rain, right?
Amen.
It's coming down. Now we're looking for the spiritual rain, right? He says in his word that the latter rain would overtake the former rain, right? So we want the rain of God. Amen. I got a few announcements this morning, but welcome all. Welcome anyone that's new. We have a few. I think it was David and Araceli are here today with us. Amen. And some of the rest of the people I see have been here before. So, but a few announcements. We have on April 25th, if you're involved here as a leader or a volunteer, we're having a meeting at 6 p.m. on Thursday, the 25th of April. So if you could make that would be great. We're going to go over vision and go over some of the stuff that we see that God wants to do, so that we have a clear direction. So we're all on the same page, you know? Not like a bunch of little islands doing different stuff. We want to be focused in on that. Also, if you look on the bulletin board in the area back there behind, near the kitchen, in the atrium area, there's a lot of stuff we put on the board there. The FemPower is having their grand opening here pretty soon. I'm not sure the date exactly, but it's on that board back there. The FemPower, the group that works with the young teen pregnancies and all that to try to encourage them to keep the baby rather than to abort them. Amen? Because we'd rather see life than death. And then the men's breakfast has had to be rerouted back to here. So April 20th, Saturday from 8 in the morning, we'll be starting at 8. We'll have the men's breakfast here in the social hall. And also that same day is when the women's have their glow meeting. But their glow meeting starts at around 10. So if we're still overlapping, that's fine, because we're kind of finalizing the men's thing around 9:30 to 10 anyways. So any of the women that want to be part of that, go ahead and come and see what that's all about. The youth revival is going to be at the Gospel Light for May 17th through the 17th and 18th, but leading up to that, they're taking any donations. So they should. Are they starting to take them now, Pam? So at this time, we're taking any volunteers for the kind of biannual rummage sale that they do here. They pack that social hall out. It looks like a thrift store, man. I'm telling you. If there's any stuff that you may have bought last year and it's still just sitting in your garage and you ain't used it and you want to clear some room, just bring it back. We'll sell it again. It's no problem. All right? Yeah, come on.
We have a needy family, single mom of seven, and she comes on Wednesdays. And I spoke with the Torados, and there's a need. They need things like clothing, shoes, and I have a clothing closet, but there's certain needs that we can't meet. And school supplies, like paper, pencils, backpacks, things like that. So I'm going to go ahead and get some sizes from Patty Torado. And if you guys want to donate toward that, their ages like from middle school all the way down to like a baby. We'll put like a box in the office, and the office is open Monday through Friday, 9 to 1. And if anybody feels that they want cleaning supplies, laundry soap, anything like this. And this woman is a very hard worker, and she's trying to get a job, and she's just asking for some help and assistance. So if the Lord puts it on your heart, we would really appreciate if you would give toward that. Okay, thank you.
Amen. That's like the body helping the body, right? We're all part of one big family. Amen. So, you guys ready? I have something to read real fast, but before that, hey, it's really important to get involved with like Bible study or into the Word. Joe and Leslie, they run a morning Bible study on Sundays, and we also run one on Wednesday nights during our Wednesday night meetings. If you can at all possible, try to get to one of those. It's real important. Marianne runs a new believers kind of discipling one for us, and on Wednesday nights, that's right here. And so yeah, if you can get plugged in, that like I said, Joe, they do it at 9:30 every Sunday morning. So it's really good. They go through the Bible, and you have a chance to ask questions. It's kind of hard to really learn stuff just from like one Sunday a week. You really got to get in on your own or go to other things to learn the Word, get it in. Because the Word will not return void when you get it into your life. Amen? Psalm 66 says this, "Make a joyful shout to God, all the earth. Sing out the honor of His name. Make His praise glorious. Say to God, how awesome are your works. Through the greatness of your power, your enemies shall submit themselves to you. All the earth shall worship you and sing praise to you. They shall sing praises to your name." Are y'all ready to praise the King? Father, we thank you for today. We thank you, Holy Spirit. Come and have your way, Lord. Come and abide with us here, Lord. Come and do what you want to do into the hearts of the people, Lord. Touch each and every one, Lord. We open ourselves up to you. We surrender to you. We give you all the glory and honor and say, have your way, Lord. Not our will, but your will be done. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. You want to stand, stand, sit, whatever you want to do. Have freedom.
All right, good morning, church. It's good to see everybody here today. I know it's raining outside, but we're going to enter into a time of worship here this morning. Let's sing this out together. Sing out, he's coming on the cloud.
He's coming on the clouds. Kings and kingdoms will bow down. Every chain will break. His broken hearts to carry his praise. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Cause our God is the Lion, the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power, he's fighting our battles, and who can stop the Lord Almighty? Cause our God is the Lamb, the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before him.
So open up the gate.
So open up the gates. Make way before the King of Kings. Oh, the God who came to save. He's here to set the captives free. For who can stop the Lord Almighty?
Our God.
Cause our God is the Lion, the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power. He's fighting our battles. And every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain. For the sins of the world, His blood breaks the chains. In every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him.
lift us up together. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Oh. Let's lift it up. Who can stop? Oh, and who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Yeah. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord?
We're singing over you.
Yeah. Who can stop the Lord Almighty?
Who can stop the Lord?
Who can stop the Lord Almighty?
No one.
Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord?
Cause our God, he is a lion, the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power, he's fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before him. And our God is a lamb, the lamb that was slain for the sins of the world.
Blood brings the chains in. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. Oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh. Oh, every knee will bow, yeah.
So,
great is your faithfulness.
Great is your faithfulness, oh God. You wrestle with the sinner's heart. Oh, when you lead us by still waters into mercy. And nothing can keep us apart.
So remember.
So remember your people. Remember your children. Remember your promise, oh God. Oh God, oh, in your grace is enough.
Justice, God of Jacob.
You use the weak to lead the strong.
Did you lead us?
You lead us in the song of your salvation. And all your people sing along, sing along. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, oh God. Oh.
grace is enough for me. So remember, lift it up, church, you're great. Cause your grace is enough. Come on. Your grace is enough. Yes, it is. Cause your grace is enough for me.
Amen. So this next one is one we haven't done here before. This was this goes way back. I used to play this one in youth group way back in the day when I was a young man. And so
A young man.
This is a song by Phil Wickham. This one's called Carnes. And I just love the beauty of this. It talks a lot about just God's creation and just really listening and being in tune with what he's saying, not only in our lives, but just in nature and what he's created for us, just seeing the beauty. I think sometimes in the busyness of life, it just gets crazy, and we don't necessarily always pay attention to those things. So I just love this psalm right here. It goes like this.
It's falling from the clouds, strange and lovely sound. I hear it in the thunder and the rain. It's ringing in the skies like cannons in the night. As the music of the universe plays, we're singing to you. Let's join in with the sound. Come on, let's sing it out. As the music of the universe plays, we're singing. We're singing, you are holy, great and mighty. The moon and the stars declare who you are. And I'm so unworthy, but still you love me. Forever my heart will sing of thy parade. All the glory, all the power is yours, amen. All glory, all the power is yours, amen. All glory, all the power is yours, forever, amen.
We lift it up, you are holy.
Singing, you are holy, great and mighty. The moon and the stars declare who you are. And I'm so unworthy.
but still you love me forever. My heart will sing about the rains to me. How great you
continue in worship. I just pray that you come with an expectant heart today of what God has for us in this service, in this message today. And that God brings a blessing today on this church, on his congregation, on his people. The Lord bless you.
Lord bless you. Face shine upon you, be gracious to you, Lord. Turn his face toward you and give peace.
Let's sing that out again. The Lord bless you. Amen, amen.
Him a singing, amen, amen, amen. Oh, we'll sing, amen, amen, amen.
The Lord.
May his favor be upon you for 1,000 generations and your family and your children and your children. Because it goes on and on. His grace never ends.
May his favor.
May his favor be upon you for 1,000 generations. In your family, in your children, in
go before you, and behind you, and beside you, all around you, and within you. He is with you, he is with you. In the morning, in the evening, when you're coming, and you're going, in your weeping and rejoicing, he is for you. He is
in the morning,
go in the morning, in the evening, in the coming, in your going, in your weeping and rejoicing, he is for you. 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 Church is one body.
Singing Amen, Amen, Amen,
Amen, Amen. We sing Amen, Amen, Amen.
We lift it up, we lift it up.
Against you, that his thoughts towards you are nothing but good. Amen. That he has a purpose and a plan, and we have an expected end. God is for you. Who can be against you? Nobody. He even says even the weapons of our enemy would not prosper against us. All we have to do is keep trusting him. Amen. Just trust him. Have faith. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. We thank you for your goodness. Thank you for all you've done for us, Lord, and all you're going to do, Lord. Thank you that you're a shield about us, a very present help in time of need. Hallelujah. Well, this is the time where we get to honor God with what he's given us to help support his work and what he wants to do, you know, to support the heating, electric, outreach, supporting other things in the community like the Wellness Center, PAR, and all the other places that we also give to as we receive. But it's not out of compulsion. God loves a cheerful giver, and it's never out of duty. It's whatever God puts upon each of your hearts. Ask the Lord. Said, Lord, what would you have me give today? Right? Because truly, we belong to him, and everything that we have belongs to him. Everything we see belongs to him. He's just entrusted us as stewards with what he's given us, including our own life. And so, in Romans 12, it says to present ourselves a living sacrifice. So God, what he wants is 100% of you. And then he asks you to do things. So, Father, we thank you. Speak to your people, Lord. Your sheep hear your voice, Lord, even as you said in your word. Whatever it is that they should give today to help support what you're doing, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. And you know, as they clear your aisle, get up and greet one another. Go and shake a hand, introduce yourself to someone you may not know, and just encourage one another like families do, right? Like when cousins come and uncles and aunts from far away and we go, hey, so good to see you. Amen. Thank you. Hallelujah. Oh, we have sound. How y'all doing out there? And highly favored of the Lord. Amen. That's the right confession of your mouth, right? We want to always agree with God's word and not be in disagreement. We want to speak the truth in love, even to our own selves, no matter what the situation looks like. So, Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, that it goes forth and accomplishes all you want it to do, Lord. I thank you, Lord, that it will not return void. I thank you that each of the members of your body that are here today and those that may be hearing later on any recording, Lord, that they have good soil in their heart to receive the engrafted word of God that's able to save them and to have them prosper in everything they do for your kingdom, Lord, to bring about maturity in our lives, to help us to grow up and be all that you call us to be, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're going to talk today about the God of hope. We have hope, right? That word hope, Baker's Evangelical Dictionary says this: hope means to trust in, wait for, look for, or desire something or someone, or to expect something beneficial in the future. The Thayer lexicon says it like this: hope could be an expectation of evil or fear. Sometimes people expect things like that, or it's an expectant that something's coming so you can prepare, right? But also it's an expectation of good or hope. In the Christian sense, it's joyful and confident expectation of eternal salvation. On hope, in hope, having hope. The author of hope, or he who is its foundation, the thing hoped for. And Strong's Concordance defines hope as to anticipate, usually with pleasure, expectation or confidence, to have faith or hope. Let's look at Romans 15, chapter 13, or chapter 15, verse 13. If you have your Bibles, and if you take notes, sometimes I go a little fairly quick through the scriptures, but usually it's enough time to be able to write down the references. Amen. Romans 15, 13 reads like this: now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that you may abound or be superabundant in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit that came in, God's goodness. The Holy Spirit led us to God's goodness, that led us to repentance, that brought us into his family. And then he says, I'm not going to leave you or forsake you, but I'm going to go ahead and move on in and make myself at home inside of you, if you will allow him. He'll abide in you and we abide in him. And so God, who is our teacher and our guide and the one that we hope for, our hope is in him. Christ in you, the hope of glory, right? And so we have hope in him if we have him. And him is Jesus. The Spirit of Christ that dwells in us, the Holy Spirit, bears witness with our spirit that we are his, according to Scripture. Romans 15, chapter 15, verse 4. Well, let me read this first. Ephesians 2, 11 and 12. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 11 and 12. At one time, we didn't have hope, right? We were hopeless. I know I was. I was very hopeless. I was hopeless and lost, wandering in this world, going the wrong way. I may have seemed like to people that I was doing okay or doing different things, but I was still without hope because I didn't have Christ. In Ephesians 2:11 and 12, it speaks about that. Therefore, remember that you, once Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision made in the flesh by hands, that at the time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But because of Christ's blood, as it reads in the next verse, we have been brought near. And it was the blood of Christ that was shed that paid the penalty of the sin that separated us from God, where we had no hope. Now we have hope because we have Christ, right? We've accepted him. Look at Romans 15, verse 4. For whatever things were written before were written for our learning, that we through the patience and comfort of the scriptures might have hope. So that tells me the scriptures is what helps us have faith in the hope that's before us, the hope that we're looking for. And the hope that I'm mostly talking about today, we're going to see that he had promised it, that he said he would return and get us, and that we would be resurrected, and we would have the resurrection and life. We have it now while we're walking, but we don't have that new body yet. That's the hope, that you won't leave us in the state we're in, because originally man was designed to live forever and to enjoy God and to worship him and praise him and be thankful to him, right? But sin entered and it was corrupted. And so that's our hope, is that we're not going to be left in the state that we're in. Because he said, because of that, death entered into the world and it also affected us. So we don't live forever anymore. We see that. We see people that in the flesh, in these bodies, they deteriorate just like everything around us, right? Just look at, you know, I mean, a lot of times my wife will work real hard. She'll clean a certain room in the house. I won't say names. Some of you might have some of them. But it's clean, but then it's left to itself, and disorder takes over, and it deteriorates. It begins to become more messy, more dusty, right? Well, it's the same with everything. Everything, including our life, it's passing away. We're passing away, the house that we're in. But we have life. Who we really are inside of this tent or this house that we're living in, we have life, and the life givers inside of us, that's the hope that we have. And he says, I'm not going to leave you in that state. I'm coming back to get you. The hope he will return and get us of the resurrection life. Look at Acts 23, verse 6. And we'll read verse 26, or verse 6 in 23. It says, but when Paul perceived that one part were Sadducees and the others Pharisees, he cried out in the council, men and brethren, I am a Pharisee, the son of a Pharisee. Concerning the hope and resurrection of the dead, I am being judged. See, Paul knew what the hope was, the hope in the resurrection from the dead. That we're not going to all sleep forever, that we are going to raise up with him, the one that is the resurrection and the life, right? Paul knew that, and he used that to his advantage, because the Sadducees didn't believe in the resurrection after death, but the Pharisees did, so he used that to kind of cause a little schism between the two, because they were judging him for certain things. He was within the Sanhedrin, and they were divided over what to do with him. Look at 24, verse 15 of Acts. Here again we see that word hope. With Paul, with his defense before Felix, he said, I have hope in God, which they themselves also accept, that there will be a resurrection of the dead, both of the just and the unjust. See, it's given unto men once to die and then the judgment. We stand before God to be judged what we've done in this life with the gifts and the things he's given us. And the just and the unjust are all going to be raised to life, right? We're all going to have eternal life, believe it or not. But those that have unjust, that have eternal life, are going to be eternally separated from God, basically. They're still living on. So in the respect of life, but they're going to eternal death because separation from God is death, but they're not going to die. They're going to continue. So we have to be careful how we live in this life, what we're doing. What do we do with the gifts God's given us? And there again, I say this all the time, there's no condemnation if we're messing up, right? Romans says there's no condemnation to those that walk according to the Spirit. So we repent, we move on. We don't allow that to linger on us like, man, I messed up. I'm separated forever. That's a lie of the devil. You're not separated forever. You can repent and be right back in the grace of God, moving forward right again. It's that simple, right? And as you grow in grace, you learn to know that. But it's not a license for us to keep doing the wrong things. God's grace will start to teach us to deny ungodly lusts, it says in Scripture. It teaches us. It's a teacher. So as we grow in grace, we're learning to walk more like Christ, right? Amen. Amen. So 1 Corinthians 15, let's look there, verse 19, we'll start in. And it reads like this. We'll read 19 through 21. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men the most pitiable or miserable. But now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the firstfruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. He said he's coming back to get us. He said he was the resurrection and the life. Here we see that if we only have him for this life, we're most miserable. The hope is in the next life. The hope is in he's coming back. The hope is in that we have an eternal home that far exceeds what we see here, right? Hebrews talks about we're pilgrims passing through, seeking out and looking for a city whose builder and maker is God, right? It's a city that God's building, that he's making. That it's not a democracy. It's not a communist-ruled government. It is a theocracy. It is God-ruled. God, because he knows best, he knows the end from the beginning, it's going to be perfect, right? It's going to be perfect. So we have this hope in us. He even promised it. Look at Titus 1, verse 2. The promise of God. The promises of God are yes and amen. So when I see promises, I go, yes and amen. Which amen means so be it. Yes, amen. So be it, Lord. Titus 1, verse 2. Says, in hope of eternal life, which God, who cannot lie, promised before time began. So this hope that we have of this glorified body to be in his presence for all eternity, it was thought of by God even before everything was created, before time even existed. He already had it set up. The plan was there. He promised it before time began. Look at John 14, verse 1 through 3. And this is God speaking. God the Word. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. His name was Jesus. In John 14, 1, going through 3, it says, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions, or rooms, you could say. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. So God promised before time this was going to happen, this hope we have. Christ reiterated it right here in John 14, saying, I'm going to prepare it, and I'm coming back to get you, right? And in Revelations 1:8, he says what? He says this in a vision to John, the apostle on Island Patmos. He had a revelation of Jesus Christ, and he said, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, says the Lord, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. He's coming. Are you ready? He's coming. You know, a while back we did a message on having and being prepared, having the oil in our lamps like the five wise bridesmaids and not the five foolish ones, being prepared. Because he's coming. And the times that we're living in, and you look around, it's drawing very close. Because it said in the days, like the days of Noah, would be the return of Christ. And when he's coming to get us. Right? We were justified by what he did on the cross. We're being sanctified as we walk through this life, which means we're being set apart, we're being transformed into his image, we're being made better and better. But when he comes, we're going to be glorified. Just like when he left, he says, don't touch me yet, I'm being glorified, right? His body was glorified, couldn't touch him. When he spoke to the woman, I believe it was, in the Gospels, we will be glorified with him. We'll have a glorified body. And we'll be like him, it says. But he's coming. He is coming. So we must have faith and believe. Look at Romans 8. It's a good chapter to read, by the way. Romans 8, actually all of Romans is good. All the Bible's good, but chapter 8's a good one. It talks about free from the indwelling sin in our lives. And then the sonship through the Spirit. But in verse 24, it says this. For we were saved in this hope, but hope that is seen is not hope, for why does one still hope for what he sees? A lot of people say, show me and then I'll believe. But in God's kingdom, it's believe and then you'll see. Right? When you believe, you see. That's when your eyes become open. That's why he said, I once was blind, but now I see. Because I've accepted Christ. Now I can see. He's showing me. Right? And we have this hope and an expected end. But we patiently wait for it, right? It's been how many thousands of years now? Each generation, it's like, Jesus is coming. Jesus is coming. Right? Every generation, Jesus is coming. But were the signs of the times then like they are now? Like in the days of Noah, when the thoughts of men's heart were exceedingly evil, right? And we look around, can it get any worse? I don't know. Israel just got attacked. That's another interesting thing going on there when you look at Bible prophecy stuff. They were just attacked by Iran. And he's coming back. And we wait for it patiently. Look at the next verse in chapter 8 of Romans where we're at. But if we hope for what we do not see, we eagerly wait for it with perseverance. Likewise, in verse 26, the Spirit also helps in our weakness, for we do not know what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself makes intercession for us with groaning which cannot be uttered. So the Spirit in us is helping us, is making intercession on our behalf. And then not only do you have that, but you have Christ who's seated at the right hand of the Father that ever makes intercession for us as the high priest on behalf of his children and his people, which is us. So, man, you can't lose. So the Son and the Spirit are both interceding for us. And the Father's going, yep, I hear that. You're praying my will. You can expect it to happen. Because if we ask anything according to the will of God, we can expect it. So we persevere, we wait for this hope. We want to have this glorified body, right? And he is coming. In 1 Thessalonians 4, if you turn there, we'll start in verse 13. It talks about encouraging one another in this hope that we have. So are we encouraging one another? Are we building one another up? Because we shouldn't be tearing people down, especially the family of God. We should be encouraging them to walk and to run their race. Come on, you can do it. Most armies, you know, we've been enlisted in the army. Most armies, when their fellow soldier gets wounded, they pick them up and try to get them to help. But more times than not, in a lot of the church, they just kick them, step over them, trample them down, and move on, you know. But that ought not to be. We ought to be encouraging. We ought to like, yeah, okay, you're in some mud, you know. You're with the hogs. Here, let me give you a hand, help you out, and point you in the right direction. You know, you need to go back to the light. Go to the light. The light. Go to the light, right? You're in darkness. Go to the light. So, but that's what we do, or we should do. 1 Thessalonians 4:13. But I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. He's coming back. He's coming back for you. He's coming back for a church without spot and wrinkle. How's that happen? Because the Spirit in us is helping us to become without spot and wrinkle. The blood of Christ covers us to be without spot and wrinkle. All we have to do is trust and believe, and keep doing what we're doing. And just because he's coming, we don't sit down. No, there's work to do. Jesus said this. He said to his disciples, he said, my meat or my sustenance, the food that I get nourishment from, is to do the will of my Father who sent me and to complete his work. He ascended on high, and then he sent us to do the work, to complete the Father's work. So we're to continue in doing the things we know to do until we hear that trumpet, right? Oh, Jesus is coming back. It'll be tomorrow. I'm going to just go sit and hang out and get things in order. Nope, we just keep going because no man knows the hour nor the time. Only the Father in heaven knows when he's going to hand a scroll to him or whatever and say, here, it's time to go. Get up from your seat of intercession and go get my people. Right? And he's going to do it. I think it's in our lifetime, but I could be wrong. Many before have thought that. Right? But nonetheless, be prepared. Be ready. Each day, you can look up and go, Lord, is this the day? Is this the day that you're coming? Is this the day I'm going home? Right? We all have expiration dates. We just don't know when it is. Only he does. Titus 2 tells us to keep looking for his coming. Look at Titus chapter 2, verse 11. We'll start and we'll read through 14. Whose mouths must be stopped. So he's talking about some in. Well, let's start at 10. For there are many insubordinate, both idle talkers and deceivers, especially those of the circumcision, whose mouths must be stopped, who subvert whole households, teaching things which they ought not for the sake of dishonest gain. One of them, a prophet of their own, said, Cretans are always liars, evil beasts, lazy gluttons. This testimony is true. Therefore, rebuke them sharply, that they may be sound in faith. You know, I'm reading the wrong scripture here. Excuse me. I do that sometimes. That's chapter 1. So chapter 2, verse 11. I said, this don't sound right. Here's where it says the grace of God teaches us to deny ungodly lusts. Right here. Starting verse 11. But he is coming, and we have to keep looking. It says, for the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodly and worldly lusts, we should be live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age, looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us, that we might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself his own special people, zealous for good works. And then an encouragement again. Speak these things, exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no one despise you. So you see here, he's saying he gave himself to redeem us, own special people. Keep looking. He's coming. You are a special person. That's part of his family, right? Now, this word perseverance in 1 Thessalonians 5:8, I wanted to talk a little about that. We'll read 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 8. And it says this. But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and as a helmet, the hope of salvation. That word salvation is what I want to talk about a little right there. We're to persevere, like it says, to persevere, have this hope, have faith. That word in the Thayer is soteria, and we translate it salvation, but it has these meanings: deliverance, preservation, safety, salvation, deliverance from the molestation of enemies. In an ethical sense, that which concludes to the soul's safety or salvation, of messianic salvation, salvation as the present possession of all true Christians. So when he says here that we put on the breastplate of faith, live soberly, put on love, the helmet of the hope of salvation, it's saying that this salvation is deliverance from the enemies that deter us, to try to get us off track, to try to separate us from God. Right? We have a hope that God's moving on our behalf to keep us from that. We have the hope that what he said is true, and we have authority, even as he has said, to trample down the works of the enemy. Right? In this life. But now look at the definition as we go into the third part of that definition of that word soteria. Future salvation. The sum of benefits and blessings which the Christians, redeemed from all earthly ills, will enjoy after the visible return of Jesus from heaven in the consummated and eternal kingdom of God. So not only is that word encompass the hope we have while we're walking through this life and the things that we can overcome because of he's an overcomer and he lives in us, but it's also that hope that he's coming again to give us a glorified body and everything's going to be consummated. We're going to be at a big feast table enjoying a huge meal together with all the saints that have gone before and all those that are going to go and all those that are in our generation. It's going to be huge. How'd you like to be one of the servers at that place? Huh? Man, I'm wondering how long it's going to take to pass all the food out. That's a lot of people, all right? At least what we know from how many people have gone before. But there's a lot that won't make it either. And that's why we have to be about the Father's business, reaching out to people. Amen? In Hebrews 3:6, about talking about this perseverance, it says this, but Christ as a son over his own house, whose house we are, if we hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of the hope firm to the end. So we got to persevere. Hang on to Jesus. Don't let go. Hang on to the word. Don't let go. Don't doubt. Believe. No matter how crazy it may seem to your mind, believe what the word says. You know, you might look at it and go, man, that's crazy. Or however crazy it is that the Spirit of God tells you to do something, just do it and watch what happens. Say, I'm just going to trust you, Lord. I know years ago I was witnessing to a person. He was belligerent and drunk. I was talking to him, and he was getting tensed up and real aggressive. And I'm sitting there like going, all right, time to do some. Let's get it on, all right? And all of a sudden, the Spirit of God goes, I got this. And I go, okay, Lord, I'll just trust you. So I put my hands down the side, and I just stood there talking to him. Swung at me 3 times and couldn't hit me. Stopped right here. Like there was like a hand there. But never touched me. Next day, the guy apologized. I'm sorry, man. I was a little drunk. I go, I know. That's why I'm talking to you, trying to help you, man. It was Bob. I prayed for Bob a lot. But my point is that seemed crazy, right? Hey, I'm about to get hit in the face. Nah, I don't know, man. I'm going to take care of this myself. I go, the dude's drunk. He's probably don't got much wherewithal, right? But no matter how crazy it is, just trust God. Lean upon him, right? What's it say? Trust in the Lord with all your heart, right? Lean on him. Acknowledge him in all your ways. Don't let it get to your head. Don't try to reason around the cross, reason around the things. Just trust him. Amen. And we have this assurance that he's coming. Look at Hebrews 6. We'll read verse 13 through 20. For when God made a promise to Abraham, because he could swear by no one greater, he swore by himself, saying, surely blessing, I will bless you, and multiply, and I will multiply you. And so after he had patiently endured, he obtained the promise. He patiently endured and obtained the promise. Isaac was born, and that started a chain of events that led to your descendants are like the stars, Abraham, of which we are even part of Abraham's family. We were grafted in, right? We were grafted in as children of faith. He believed God and didn't doubt. For men indeed swear by the greater, and no oath for confirmation is for them an end of all dispute. Thus God, determining to show more abundantly to the heirs of promise, say, I am an heir of promise. This is talking about you. It's talking about me. It's talking about us. God determined to show more abundantly to the heirs of promise the immutability, in other words, he ain't like lying, right? That means like it's unchangeable. It doesn't change. God don't change his mind. The immutable of his counsel confirmed it by an oath. And then 18, that by two immutable things in which it is impossible for God to lie, we might have strong consolation who have fled for refuge to lay hold of the hope set before us. Lay hold of the hope set before us. What I'm saying, I could get the worship team to come. What I'm saying is, don't lose faith. Don't lose hope. You can do it. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. No weapon of the enemy formed against you can prosper to get you away from him. Nobody can take you away from God. He's got you. Just keep going. Don't let the cares of this world choke the word out and cause you to stumble or fall away. Continue to believe God and trust him, because he's coming back. He is coming. I'm fully convinced God is coming back. I have no doubt that he will be back, and he's coming for his people. Right? Amen. Well, we're going to do this last song. If you want to stand, you know, we've been doing songs. The last song is like a special song. It's a song that one of the team members of the worship team may have written that God's given them. This song is a song that's called Come to Me. It's quite fitting, right? Stay hold of Christ. Come to me. And so it's a song that when we used to pastor at our house, a home fellowship we had for many years, it's a song that came out of that time. It's called Come to Me. It was a spiritual song that came forth during our worship time. And Matt here has fine-tuned it, and it's like even better than it was. It's like the $6 million man, right? It could be better than it was. He's made it great. You know, it was good, but now it's great. So I encourage you, stand, listen, close your eyes if you want, and hear the words. It's powerful. Amen.
Father says, come to me. You know, we wrote this song, Marshall gave me some words. We tweaked them just a little bit, but I love the message, and those are going to be up on the screen for you if you want to read it. You catch on to the lyrics, it goes like this.
Just come to me,
Amen. Father says, come to me. Be separate, ye, from things in this world. Draw close. When we draw close, he draws close to us. And eventually, we're just embracing one another. You can get there. Amen. Perhaps you were hearing the message of hope today, and maybe you struggle with some things about hope. If so, I'm going to open up the altars here to pray. If I can have some of my prayer team members come up, maybe Nancy, my wife, Marianne, Joe and Leslie, depending on how many people come. But if you want prayer, please come up. We'll pray with you. We'll believe with you. We'll stand with you. Amen. We'll believe God on your behalf. We do that anyways, praying in intercessory prayer here the times we meet, but we'll pray right here. If not, you're free to go. Just remember we have bread in the back social hall that Joe works hard. Sometimes Eddie helps out too and gets the bread and brings it just to bless the people. You got the spiritual bread, and there's some physical bread. Amen. So Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for our brethren, Lord. We thank you for our family, both that are here and that are abroad, that are all around, maybe the ones could make it, Lord. We thank you that you're a shield about them, Lord, a very present help in time of need, that you are protecting and watching over them, Lord. Give them divine appointments as they go through the week to help be a light, to share the gospel, the good news, and the hope that is in us, Lord. The hope that you're coming again. The hope that we can speak forth your words and see life come to people and lives change, situations change. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.